Hello friends, welcome to YouTube channel Electronics. Today we will learn about semiconductors. Semiconductors are used in almost all electronic devices. Their controlled conduction of electricity makes them ideal to be used in wide range of electronic components like diodes, transistors, integrated circuits and etc. As we know, all materials can be classified as conductors, insulators and semiconductors according to their electrical conductivity. Materials like gold and copper, which transfers electricity through them, are called conductors. Materials like wood and plastic, which doesn't transfer electricity through them, are called insulators. There are some materials like silicon and germanium, which are neither good conductors nor insulators. Their electrical conductivity is in between conductors and insulators. These materials are classified as semiconductors. Electric conductivity is measured in Siemens per meter. The conductivity of conductors is in between 10 to the power of 4 to 10 to the power of 7 Siemens per meter. Semiconductors conductivity is in between 10 to the power of minus 6 to 10 to the power of 4 Siemens per meter. And insulators conductivity is less than 10 to the power of minus 10 Siemens per meter. This table showing two important characteristics, resistivity and temperature coefficient of resistance. It is to be noted that semiconductors have negative temperature coefficient. The resistance decreases with increase in temperature. But why electrical conductivity of conductors, semiconductors and insulators are different? All materials are composed of tiny particles called atoms. The structure of an atom looks like this. An atom consists of central nucleus of positive charge. Around the nucleus, there are different circular paths or orbits, in which negatively charged electrons moves. The number of electrons in any orbit is known by formula 2n square, where n is the number of orbit. The electrons in the lost orbit or valence electrons determines the electrical property of an element. The outermost orbit can possess maximum 8 electrons. Conductors have less than 4 valence electrons. So, they are loosely attached with the nucleus and even at room temperature, they can become free electrons. When number of valence electrons in an atom is more than 4, the element behaves as an insulator. The valence electrons are strongly attached with the nucleus. Hence, no free electrons available in the structure. Semiconductors have 4 valence electrons. So, they have moderate bonding with the nucleus. Hence, very few free electrons available at room temperature. In terms of energy band, conductors have valence and conduction bands or overlap each other. Thus, valence electrons can move easily to conduction band. Insulators have large forbidden energy gap between their conduction and valence band. Hence, it is not possible for valence electrons to enter into conduction band. While semiconductors have small forbidden energy gap between their valence and conduction bands. Hence, some valence electrons will enter into their conduction band. So, semiconductors do have very few electrons at room temperature. Hence, it passes a tiny current through it. Silicon, germanium and gallium arsenide are some of the most commonly used semiconductors. Let us try to understand the behavior of semiconductor by taking example of silicon. Silicon's atomic number is 14, means it has 14 electrons rotating around the nucleus. Its outermost orbit has 4 valence electrons. When silicon atoms come close to each other to form a solid, they share their valence electron and arranges in a crystal-like structure. Each silicon atom shares 4 valence electrons with the 4 neighboring atoms. And 4 neighboring atoms will share each valence electron with this atom. Therefore, each silicon atom has total 8 valence electrons. So, by sharing valence electrons, silicon atoms form covalent bonds. When the temperature just above 0 degree Kelvin, due to the thermal energy supplied to the crystal, some electrons tend to move out of their place and breaks covalent bonds. These broken covalent bonds results free electrons. But the moved away electrons creates an empty space which is called as a hole. We know that the charge of an electron is -1.6 multiplied with 10 to the power of -19 coulombs. By not having an electron, hole creates a positive charge. The positively charged holes can attract other free electrons in the structure. Let's say this free electron gets recombined with this hole. This recombination results release of heat, which breaks another covalent bond. Suppose due to thermal energy, this electron becomes free and gets recombined with this hole. So, when temperature increases, the rate of generation of electron and holes increase. Thus, the rate of recombination of electrons also increases. For every generated electron, a hole is also getting generated. Hence, we can say that at any given temperature, equal number of free electrons and holes are created in the silicon structure. And one more thing is that electrons and holes move from one place to the other's place and occupies each other's place. So, in semiconductors, we get flow of current due to the movement of two types of charges, movement of electrons and movement of holes. This is the biggest difference between conductors and semiconductors. In case of conductors, we get flow of current only due to electrons. But in semiconductors, we get current flow due to both types of charges, electrons and holes. Semiconductors can be classified into two types. First one, intrinsic semiconductor, and second one, extrinsic semiconductor. An intrinsic semiconductor is extremely pure form of semiconductor. It is made up of only a single type of element. For example, if we take silicon crystal, then in the intrinsic semiconductor, all the atoms would be silicon only. Second one, extrinsic semiconductor. In order to increase the conduction capability of a semiconductor, we add some impurities to intrinsic semiconductor. This process of adding impurities to semiconductor called doping. Here, arsenic impurities are introduced in silicon structure. So, depending on the type of impurity is added to the semiconductor, extrinsic semiconductors further classified as p-type and n-type semiconductors. To form a p-type semiconductor, a pure semiconductor, for example, silicon is doped with trivalent atoms. Trivalent atoms means these atoms have 3 valence electrons in their outermost orbit. Aluminium, boron and gallium are few examples of trivalent atoms. For example, if boron atom is added to the silicon atoms, since boron is a trivalent atom, its 3 valence electrons get attached with silicon atoms to form 3 covalent bonds. But one more electron in silicon remains without forming any bond. The vacancy is treated as a hole. Hence, we can say that every trivalent atom creates one hole. So, by adding small amount of trivalent impurities, we can create excess amount of holes in the crystal structure. These trivalent atoms are known as acceptor atoms. because each hole which is created by the atoms can accept external free electron. Similarly, by adding pentavalent impurity to a pure semiconductor, n-type semiconductor can be formed. Pentavalent atoms means there are 5 valence electrons in their outermost orbit. Arsenic, antimony and phosphorus are the few examples of pentavalent atoms. For example, if arsenic atom is added to silicon atoms, then out of the 5 valence electrons of arsenic atom, 4 valence electrons get attached with the silicon atoms to form 4 covalent bonds, while 1 extra electron remains as a free electron. So, we can say that each pentavalent atom creates 1 free electron. So, by adding small amount of pentavalent impurities, we can create excessive amount of free electrons in the silicon crystal structure. These pentavalent atoms are called donor atoms, because the atom donates a free electron for conduction in the lattice. So, in case of p-type semiconductor, there is excessive amount of holes. So, holes are the majority carriers and electrons are minority carriers. Hence, whenever we apply voltage to the p-type semiconductor, the holes will get attracted towards negative terminal, while the electrons will get attracted towards positive terminal. But as the electrons are less in this p-type semiconductor, the majority of the current we will get is due to holes. In case of n-type semiconductor, there is excessive amount of electrons. So, electrons are majority carriers and holes are minority carriers. Hence, whenever we apply voltage to n-type semiconductor, then electrons will get attracted towards positive terminal, while the holes will get attracted towards negative terminal. And the majority of current flow is due to electrons. So, in this way, in semiconductors, we get flow of current due to two types of charges, electrons and holes. Here in this table, I have summarized the differences between intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductors. Please go through it. That's all about semiconductors. If you have learned from this video, please do mention them in the comment section below. In next video, we will discuss what will happen when we combine p-type and n-type semiconductors, that is p-n junction. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, please click like button. Help others to learn by sharing this video. Please subscribe and turn on notifications for more such videos. Have a nice day.